I received this nice German wall clock the other day. It belongs to Terri and Paul from Whitman County in Washington State. It has a decorative top piece with an eagle on the top, but it wasn't sent with the clock. The back has a very nice double book-matched wood grain pattern along with a four-corner match in the middle. The numbers and minute track on the porcelain dial are hand-painted. Has a couple of stress cracks on it. Bezel has several dents and cracks in the brass. This zinc-plated screw is not original to the clock. Cracks in the bezel almost extend clear through to the front. This is a pressed bezel and is paper thin. Very fragile and in a distressed condition. Minute hand looks like it has some thick touch-up paint in this area here. This looks like a crack or crease of some sort. It's missing the brass keyhole grommet from the dial on this side. The bottom bracket has some nice Victorian scroll work on it. This green residue is old clock oil that has turned gummy. Steel parts on this clock are pitted. Definite signs of moisture damage. The green deposits in the gear teeth and pinions is old dried clock oil. Here's some of it right here. Here's some old gummy oil. The stamp Deutsches Reich, patent number 55006, indicate the clock may have been made by Heinrich Kilman in the 1890s. This patent was issued to Heinrich in 1890 or 1891. It patented how the hanging of the pendulum was done. Heinrich manufactured loose movements for other manufacturers to use also. He also allowed other makers to manufacture their own movements using his patented pendulum hanging system. So movements from other makers have this patent number stamped on them as well. The patent prevented the suspension springs from twisting and breaking from fatigue. Four small pins that lock these suspension springs in position. This square wedge locks the suspension spring assembly in place. prevents it from falling out of the pendulum rod mount. This round brass rod is part of the patent. You can see tool marks on the ends where it was cut on the lathe. They spiral out from the center. These two slots cut into it keep the pendulum from twisting and overswinging when fitted into this double hanger clip. I see this hanger is bent a little bit too much on one end. To straighten it will cause stress. It might break. So I'm going to leave it alone. More Victorian scrollwork. A nice example of a temperature-compensated Gridian pendulum rod. These were only used in precision clocks. These alternating parallel brass and steel rods have different thermal expansion coefficients. Mounted in this brass mount, their different thermal expansions and contractions compensate for each other. So the overall length of the pendulum stays constant with temperature changes. Looking at the Victorian scrollwork, it should be facing to the front. This pendulum bob has been mounted backwards on this pendulum rod. These two pieces of round brass spacers don't belong here. One of them is a brass top to a spark plug. The R and A on the bob stand for retard and advance. It indicates which way to turn the adjustment screw on the bottom of the pendulum. Looks like this hand has been repaired with solder and a thin piece of brass used as a brace. It's a weak repair because only one piece of brass was used. Not really sure if this is a crease or a crack. It's right where the straight part of the hand blends into this round area. The hour hand is intact. The hands are black, but originally would have been blued. You can see trace amounts of the blue on the back side. These original hands don't bend easily because they have been hardened and then tempered to a blue color. A wood screw. The original would have had machine threads on it. Next to the oxidized brass, you can see what's left of the gold gilt. And looking close, it's covered with small round black corrosion specks on the brass. The movement is fastened to the dial with these brass taper pins. It's missing a pin here. It's a two-piece dial, minute track and centerpiece. The joint on the front has a decorative brass ring set into it. The three pieces are joined with these steel pegs. Oh, this dial post is loose. This one is loose too. All the dial posts are loose. Let the mainsprings down. These are offset bushings. They're rotated to compensate for bushing wear. Some fingerprint damage and the same round black corrosion specks on them that the bezel has. These black specks are everywhere. Remains of gold gilt. Small amount of gold gilt left here. The oil in this movement has dried to a gummy mess. Just look at the rust on the screw heads. I'd say the screws on this movement are handmade. You can see the tooling marks from the lathe, and a lot of the slots are offset, definitely slotted by hand. I never polish these types of screws because it'll remove the machining marks. the strike wheel. This 8 indicates a one movement at a time was being made when this movement was built. A lot of the parts on this movement will have an 8 stamped on them, if they are original to the movement. The verge and pallet assembly. The split collar that mounts the crutch is the slip clutch. It slips on the steel shaft to allow the clock to be set in beat. A lot of these go out of beat, and the owners don't know about the slip clutch. These screws sure look handmade. More thick oil. Wonder if all those black specks could be some type of insect secretion. This part has an H stamped on it. And another matching 8 stamp. Another matching part. The main springs are quite dirty. Now this barrel cap has an 8 and a dot stamped on it. This one, just an 8 by itself. I've cleaned the movement, pegged all the pivot holes out clean. I peg them until the pegboard comes out clean. All the steel parts are pitted. On the plates, you can see the pits where the round black specks were. They've etched themselves right into the brass. Time to assemble. Clock these strike pins correctly. And this lock pin needs to be clocked to the lock lever. The warning pin needs to be clocked to about the 1 o'clock position. Second wheel needs to be clocked when the strike wheel is clocked to the lock lever. All the pins, levers, wheels, and pinions need to be clocked correctly, or it's not going to strike correctly. I oiled just enough to fill any gap between the pivot and the pivot hole. The plates must have been like a mirror when they were new. It's been running non-stop for a week now. If you look close, you can see the lift pins lifting the hammer each time. Testing the half hour and hour strike. Those black specks sure etched into the brass plates.